First of all, thank you for coming. Good night, everybody. Tonight we have this opportunity to listen to the lecture Frame Magazine, The Transformation of Print, by Robert Thiemann, founder and editor-in-chief of Frame, a company based in Amsterdam. Welcome, Robert, and thank you very much for being here tonight with us. You probably all know that magazine. I think Frame is actually the proof of Robert's passion for the beauty of creativity, since the magazine stands out for its quality in the editorial process, the conception, the in-depth content, and the amazing cover designs, all printed in high quality paper. At least that was what attracted me at that time to that fantastic magazine. So very soon, this magazine became the most important and most influential magazine for interior architecture after it was launched in 1997. Robert is educated as a chemical engineer and worked as a copywriter and editor before he founded Frame. And later, some years later, in 2005, I think he co-founded Mark. It's another magazine for architecture exclusively, and then Elephant, a magazine for art and culture. When he launched Frame, the idea was to empower outstanding spatial design that was produced all over the world and was meant to inspire all of us as creative designers and professionals. He continues to explore new directions in order to communicate with the readers of Frame, and therefore he created a platform or different platforms like the 90 Minutes of Frame, which I understand is a live version of what the magazine is. And this was staged in 2013, for example, in Amsterdam, right? Mm-hmm. This was also the year when they first launched the application for the magazine, and in 2014 and 15, Robert designed or organized the pop-up stores, right?
Yes.
There were two pop-up stores that would be, let's say, the three-dimensional translation of Frame Magazine into a real shop. The result was nothing less than an award-winning pop-up store in a beautiful designed historical space in Amsterdam also. So Robert has lectured in many universities and was a member of several juries for design competitions all over the world. It's a real honor to have you here, and a privilege to listen to you and to know much more about the world of publications and magazines that we all need to know. Before Robert starts, we want to invite you to ask any questions you might have, even though he's still presenting the lecture. Anything that comes to your mind or anything that he's talking about and you want to know, so just ask him, okay? So that's it. I leave you with Robert.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. You can see me, but I really can't see you. And in order to see if you have questions, would it be possible to have a little bit more light in the room? Just a little bit? Because I would like it if you would ask questions, if you feel the urge to. Actually, that was a very good and very kind introduction, Daniela. Thank you for that. It's also part of my lecture. It's kind of a summary. So, well, you know what you will get this evening. This is the cover of the magazine that we have been making and that will be out in a couple of weeks. It's a July-August issue. So you're one of the first people outside the office who will see this cover. It's shot purposely for us, so it's a custom frame cover. And this issue is about shared living, co-living. It's becoming really hip again. But that's not what I will talk about. I will talk about for about 20 minutes about the transformation of print. Since 1997, we have been publishing this magazine, Frame. And well, making a magazine means that as an editor, you look around, you collect material, you edit the material, which means that you make selections. You say, this is good, this is interesting, this is new, this is not beautiful, this is not new, this is not interesting. And the latter you don't publish, and the good stuff you publish. You decide about how you want to publish it. You have to think about storylines, longer articles, shorter articles, many images, not many images, etc., etc. That material is taken to graphic designers working at the office in Amsterdam, and they make about 208 pages, sometimes more. And in the end, it's being printed, indeed on high quality paper, and we have a magazine, which is a summary of what the editors have seen, selected, the graphic designers have laid out, printed, and is sent into the world. It's a one-way communication system. We send signals into the world. That's what a magazine is all about. And before I continue, I am really curious who of you actually knows Frame magazine. It's about maybe 50%, maybe 60. So I've got some work to do still. And who is currently subscribing to the magazine? I'll make you a special offer. Not so many. I wonder why that is. Maybe we can talk about that a bit later on. And don't be shy. I mean, I can take it. Well, the mission of Frame is to empower spatial design excellence. We want to empower, actually, you guys and girls, especially the girls, there are many of you, to create great spaces. And in doing so, we want to connect designers, you, with makers, the industry, and clients, the people who will actually pay your bills in the end. The print run of Frame magazine currently is about 25,000. It's an international magazine. We make it in English, and we distribute the magazine in about 50 countries. 25,000 is, of course, not much. If you compare it to a magazine like Vogue America, which has a print run of, I don't know, maybe more than a million, it's not so much. In this field, it's one of the biggest, especially if you look at the B2B, business-to-business publications. Frame is one of the bigger magazines. And we specialize in commercial interiors, so we hardly ever speak about residential interiors, housing. What can you find in Frame? Well, half of you know, retail projects, so stores, hospitality, which is bars, restaurants, hotels, workplaces, events, but also the objects that you find inside interiors, lighting, furniture, floor covering, and materials, which you need to finish interiors or to come up with new concepts. In 2007, approximately 2007, something happened. Publishing also happened online. Before that, there were not many websites, blogs, or online magazines dealing with design and interior. But about 2007, 2008, we saw the birth of quite a couple of them. And now, in 2016, publishing has further changed. And we speak about omni-channel connecting, which means the following. We still make a print magazine in the old-fashioned way. Then we, as a publishing house, also have a website, and we are on social media. And this enables us to actually talk with you, or better, you can talk with us. So it's two-way communication. Online communication is two-way communication. Apart from that, we have been hosting physical events, and you see more and more publishing houses doing this, because it's no longer enough to make this stack of paper and to send it into the world or to have a web presence. People want to actually connect with the people behind publications, and they can do that at physical events. And then, based on all the expertise that we have as editors, we have been entering into consulting brands, consulting trade fairs. And that is something that I would like to grow further in the future. So you see, we began with this print magazine, and it's a whole bubble around that. 360 degrees around the print magazine, we do a lot more activities, and we need to do so. Because what has happened in the past, let's say, 15 to 20 years, that magazines, print, newspapers have all been shrinking. The print run of magazines and of newspapers has gone down. This is partly due, of course, to the rise of the internet. And now I'm very curious, who of you daily visits D-Zine? Be honest. No, that's only 25%, that's not so much. Who is a daily visitor of Design Boom? It's another 10%. Arc Daily? Haha, that's 30%. And then I miss a couple of them. But you see, these free websites, I think, have replaced many of the magazines that are on the market or have been on the market. And apart from that, I believe, but I will get to that later on, that something else has been replacing magazines. In the past, magazines were windows to the world. Editors traveled the world, saw a lot of, in our case, interiors and products. And they wrote about that, about their experiences, and shared it with their readership. Now, I think you all travel, you all go places, you all have become much more mobile. So you actually don't really need us magazine editors to tell you what's going on in other places in the world. You visit these places yourself. And what's more, you also visit festivals. Like here on the street, there's a food festival going on today with really high quality food of rather famous chefs from the city. They also provide you with inspiration. Inspiration that in the past magazines would supply. So you see, the whole landscape that magazines have been in has been changing over the past 15 to 20 years, which has made it a lot more difficult for us to survive, and which has made it crucial for us to do other things than only publishing a magazine. So what is the future as I see it for us magazine makers? I see a future still for print. We regularly do surveys among subscribers to the magazine, and we ask them, would you like to receive the magazine in print, or rather in a digital form? And always, in the last 5 years or so, about 90% says, we want to receive the magazine in print, which is good for me to know, of course. But at the same time, we see the print run going down. So I know that somewhere here, I don't know when exactly, the print run will approximately be zero, and I can shake hands with the last subscriber, and of course I want to avoid that situation. But until then, print remains our flagship. Currently, we have a really bad website. You can go there, you will find stuff, but if you compare it to D-Zine or Design Boom or Arc Daily or any other website, I don't think that we will perform well. We have been lagging behind. And this is because it is very difficult if you're in one business, which is in our case the publication of magazine, to disrupt your own business and to start your own competition, which is an online business. But this is in fact the only thing you can do to replace your old business, to be a really tough competitor of that old business, which is a magazine in our case. So until now we have been doing a really bad job. Now we are working on something new that I hope will see the light effectively end of year and make you all very happy, and me too. Then I see a good future for physical events to brand Frame magazine, but also to inspire the people visiting that event and to create matches between the visitors of such an event. And as Daniela already mentioned, in 2013 we hosted a series of events in Amsterdam in a room. It was free. It was called 90 Minutes of Frame, and it looked approximately like this. Huge screens with lots of projections, but also international speakers doing something else than only what I am doing now, telling you something and showing you slides. At one point we had this guy, this is Sam Bompas of Bompas and Parr from London. They do all kinds of creative stuff with liquids that you can drink or jelly that you can eat. And especially for our event, he had created some kind of non-alcoholic cocktail. We all had to drink it a little bit. And then he said, well, you will start to hallucinate. You will see colors in a really different way because of this cocktail. So everyone in the room, about 200 people, they drank a sip of the cocktail. And everyone had been waiting until the end of the evening for something to happen. And of course nothing happened. But in your mind, you're all the time busy thinking, when will I see something different? When will I see something different? So actually, you are experiencing something. It was really nice. We also had a lady who came in with sticks with fragrance on them, and she distributed the fragrances in the room, and you got to smell the smell of Paris, ugly, horrible, the smell of Oslo, same story, etc., etc., which was really engaging the audience. And it is such a thing that we would like to continue with in the future. Then we have created pop-up stores twice. This is the first one in an old, really old, beautiful old building in the center of Amsterdam. What we tried to do there was bring into practice what we have been preaching in the magazine, because lots of articles in the print magazine deal with retail design, with trends in retail design. So we thought, when we have the opportunity to create a pop-up store, it should be so good that actually we would want to publish it in our own magazine. And we did in the end. We sold everything from design objects to fashion, jewelry, art. We collaborated with companies that normally advertise in the magazine. So in a way, it was a three-dimensional experience of everything that Frame stands for, of the values of Frame. It looked quite cool. We had lots of publicity. We won awards. So it was very good for the Frame brand. It was not good for the company, because we have lost a lot of money with the store. Never go into retail, multi-brand retail. But, I couldn't say no to the second opportunity. So we created another pop-up store in Amsterdam, in a less beautiful space, in a less old space, in a much smaller space. We invited the same interior architects to come up with a spatial concept. And again, they came up with something really spectacular. You're looking at it. And again, we got a lot of publicity. We won a lot of prizes. As you can see, The front of the store consisted of these white panels, and at the back you could find the merchandise. So the merchandise was concealed by these panels. And these panels were meant to function as some kind of gallery. So we have projected the work of the graphic designers on top of these panels. And so we could show, we could enliven the store and make it different every so many weeks. So again, we lost money, and we were certain no more retail stores, not like this. Because for this store, we actually, we bought all this. So we tried to behave like a real multi-brand retail store. We went to Paris Fashion Week, we bought garments, and we learned how difficult it is to get rid of those pieces. You only have half a year, the spring-summer season or the fall-winter season, and almost nobody at the beginning knew that we were there with this shop, which would only exist for half a year. And at the end of the 6 months, we were stock, we were left with a lot of stock still, so we had to drastically discount and effectively well, sell the merchandise at a loss, not making any profit. So fashion retail is really, really difficult. In my opinion, a wholesale or fashion retail will, in a couple of years, well, there will be some, but there will be few left. Then the Cologne Furniture Fair asked us to do something special for one of their fairs in January, the Furniture Fair, which also has a small part dedicated to wall covering and floor covering. It's the least interesting part. And they wanted to make this part more interesting by having some kind of trend pavilion, and they asked us to create that trend pavilion. And again, we hired the same interior designers to come up with a spatial concept. We dedicated some trends, and we made these boxes, which were clad with mirror foil, which on one hand reflected like a mirror, and the other hand let you see right through them. It's kind of an interesting spatial concept. And the good thing here is that we got actually paid to do this. So the trade fair paid us to do this as a consultant. But in the meanwhile, we could also, as you can see here, brand ourselves. So that was a really nice project. Then at Milan Design Week in this April, we, for the first time ever, created an exhibition. And we wanted the exhibition to speak about the current state of affairs in design, in product design. As I said before, we are editors, which means that we look around, we see which kinds of developments, which kind of trends are there, and we try to analyze them, to interpret them, and to write about them. And we wanted to do the same thing in three dimensions, so in reality, in Milan, because I guess many of you have been to Milan. Who of you has been to Milan this year, the design event? That's about 40%. I'm very fond of percentages, as you have noticed. If you go to Milan, many, if not all, presentations are about marketing, about selling. Not only furniture and lighting and other interior product manufacturers, they market themselves, they present themselves, but also schools. Schools present themselves with the idea to find more students. Even young designers, they present themselves in order to find clients. So there's hardly ever an exhibition going on that is trying to interpret what you actually see in Milan. And this is what we have been trying to do this year. We rented the space. We again hired an interior designer. And we presented the work of about 20 creatives, ranging from animations, as you can see here, digital animations, and also on the walls at the back there, to object designers, product designers, fashion designers, and creators of strange objects, even interactive objects like this. This is a mirror that interacts with you. If you smile, you see there, that's a dandelion. It's some kind of flower. And if you smile, the dandelion inside the mirror will start to grow. Well, we try to explain this phenomenon, and we collected the works along one theme, which is called the fidgetal world. Fidgetal is a combination of physical and digital. So all the works that we showed had some relationship to the physical, but also to the digital. They made a combination of that. And we didn't get much publicity with this one. We really got some visitors though, but as you can see, they mainly came for the food. So again, looking at 2020, last thing I see as a possibility for us in order to transform ourselves is entering into consulting, which we already have done a little bit with this trade fair, in order to share the knowledge that we have and to create matches between clients and designers. Well, this is more or less what I wanted to tell you about how Frame magazine has been developing. I have another presentation which is more dealing with your field, which is in interior design. And especially with retail design. But you can also use the line of thinking that I will present here to present restaurants, bars, and even workspaces. Because it's all about getting physical in the age that we are all digital. Well, you've all got smartphones in your pocket, you have laptops. We are digital most of the day. We look at screens for maybe 8-9 hours a day. And your job is to create physical spaces. Since we are also digital, it means that the physical spaces that you will create have to have something special. But first, let's look at retail design. Retail is about buying stuff and then trying to sell that stuff. As I told you, that we have been trying to do that with the frame stores. It's really difficult. It's not only difficult because we had only been there for a couple of months. It's also difficult if you're in the business for many, many years, because we suffer of so-called stuffocation. We have a lot of stuff already. So if you want to sell more stuff, you will have a problem. This is what many girls' rooms looks like these days. Many shoes, many t-shirts, many dresses, many objects in general. So we suffer of stuffocation. Then what's happening in the world around us? You enjoy making, maybe more than buying. Especially in Amsterdam, this is very popular. Neighborhood greeneries, roof gardens, people working in small gardens and trying to grow their own vegetables, their own fruits. People are actually loving to do this. It's been a real trend. I don't know how it's here in Spain or in Barcelona, but in Holland this is, and not only in Holland, and in many cities especially, this is quite a trend. And actually, if you grow tomatoes, you don't need to buy them. Another trend is that people, for instance, make their own beer. So they don't need to buy beer, they make their own beer. Then a phenomenon that's really making it difficult for retailers to have a profitable business is sharing. Sharing is starting to beat buying. Lots of stuff that you have maybe not yet, but you will share. This company is built on sharing cars. This company is also built on sharing information. It's the biggest media owner, but it doesn't own any content. It just makes it possible for you to share content. This is the world's biggest retailer, but they don't have any inventory, so they don't buy and try to sell. They're just making connections between people. And of course, Airbnb is built on the principle of sharing apartment space. And then of course, there's Apple Music, Spotify, Netflix, all kinds of sharing services that make it that no longer make it necessary for people to actually buy something. You don't need to buy a car these days. And the last thing that is making it difficult for retailers to survive these days is the phenomenon of doing. People prefer to do instead of to buy. They go to festivals, they go to the cinema, they go to restaurants and to bars. They do fitness, they work out, go to yoga. They go to spas and wellness centers. And they visit cities to have a good time. Because in the end, we all want to feel good and to be healthy. That is by far the biggest trend that I see for the forthcoming years, the wellness trend, the well-being trend. And retailers, but also people in the hospitality industry, and even if you will create a workspace, you all have to deal with this big trend. Because time is the new wealth. It's not so much marble or gold or a big car that shows how wealthy you are. It's about how much freedom you have, how much time you have to enjoy life. And experiences, they are the new status symbol. It's not so much the size of your apartment or the brand that you are wearing, Gucci or Louis Vuitton, no. It's the festival you have been to, or that really special, peculiar pop-up restaurant you've been to that only will be there for 1 month, and you are one of the few people actually visiting this restaurant. That's the experience that you will be talking about. So what does that mean for commercial interiors in general? In general, it means that they will have to become more experiential, so speaking to the senses, and more personal, so speaking about the owner of the space. And that can be, of course, a branded space, but it could also be a restaurant which is owned by one person, or a concept store with a very strong vision owned by one person. And that person should put his personality in the store he owns. I will show you some recent examples of this trend. This is a fragrance lab inside a department store. I think it was there 2 years ago. A department store like El Corte Inglés, I don't know if you know Selfridges, it is known for this kind of thing. When you enter the shop from the street, you would see this is a shop window. People walking around, some kind of fog hanging here, people wearing lab coats, and you think, what's going on there? And you entered the room and you had to check in, fill in some kind of questionnaire. You got a headset and you had to enter a space that led you along all kinds of objects. And at the end of that tour, you had to say which kind of objects you favored, which kinds of experiences you favored. And that was combined with the answers to the questionnaire. And then this man concocted a special fragrance personally for you, especially for you. It's this kind of experience that people these days are talking about, are looking for. And this kind of experience attracts consumers to retail stores. This one you probably all know in London. There were a Dover Street Market. There were a Dover Street, hence the name Dover Street Market. Now they are in a different place. And the space looks like this. It's not your ordinary store with displays and a lot of emphasis on the fashion. No, there's a lot of emphasis on the space itself. It looks very special. And this shop rents out floor space to all kinds of other brands. This is Ralph Simons, the Belgian fashion designer. And they all create a very experiential space for themselves. Last one, this is really recent, is Julien David. It's, I think, a French fashion designer. This is a shop in Tokyo. If you look at this, you might mistake it for an art installation. It's brutal concrete and aluminium columns you're looking at. But at the other side of the columns, you will find the merchandise, the fashion, the accessories that he's making. So again, you have to explore this shop to find the merchandise, and this makes the shop engaging to visit. Another phenomenon that is current in retail, but also in the hospitality industry, brands and restaurants and bars, as in the street is happening here, they simply pop up. They no longer wait for visitors to visit them. No, they go to places where their audience is. So brands pop up at festivals. They pop up at events like the Olympic Games or the football European championship in France going on now. I'm pretty sure that, for instance, Nike is there with a pop-up store. Why pop-up stores? Brands can experiment because the store will be only there for a very short period of time. So they can experiment with new materials, with new concepts. Concept stores are, pop-up stores, of course, are very flexible. They can be there for a couple of weeks and then disappear. They're rather cheap to build. No one expects marble or any other expensive material in a pop-up store. And of course, they are really fast to conceptualize and to build and to dismantle. This is an example of Nike in Shanghai. And for the people who have gone to Milan, I'm pretty sure that you have also gone to the Nike presentation in Milan, which was actually not a shop. It looked similar, but different. Nike has a special language developed for themselves. This one you all know, the shoe brand. This is a temporary store at the campus of furniture company Vitra in Weil am Rhein in the south of Germany. It was there for a couple of months only. It's a way to experiment for Camper in this case to work with Vitra. Vitra is also manufacturing store display systems. So together they could experiment with a new way of shopping. Third phenomenon to deal with for retailers. Global brands have to become more local because you all travel. And if you travel, you don't want to see the same kind of Zara or H&M store you will also find here in Barcelona. Yet, if you look at Zara and H&M, you will find the same store actually all over the world. And some brands are now, and again, this one is a very good example, working with local architects, or not even local architects, but they try to create a local presence in each of the cities they're in to simply be different and to make you curious as to what this brand, if you like it, has been doing in Amsterdam or in Zurich or in London. And again, if you look at these shops, they are all different, but they have something in common, which is of course a very simple way of displaying shoes, the color red, and a playful arrangement of merchandise. Another brand very strong at this is Aesop, a Australian cosmetics brand known for its very graphic packaging. And the packaging of Aesop makes the stores actually. It's so graphic that it really stands out and makes for beautiful patterns. So this shop is the Aesop store in Paris. Well, there are more of them, Rue Saint-Honoré, one of the first in Paris. And as you see, the packaging actually is the hero in this shop. This one is in Central Station in New York, and it has been customized for Central Station, where you can still always find lots of newspapers to be sold. So newspaper has been recycled and is used as displays in this store. This is the one in Oslo. And again, it's different, but it's family. It shares the same DNA. And this one is in Berlin, actually designed by the same architects who designed the one in Oslo, Snøhetta. And what all the Aesop stores have in common, except for the packaging that is the hero, is a tap where you can wash your hands after having used the product. It's the introduction of a physical ritual in retail stores. And I think especially this makes the stores so good. Brands now have to combine the best of digital and physical. They have to go digital, physical, digital. Because online, you can have the biggest offer ever. You can put every single product of a collection online. A collection that would be perhaps too big to put in the stockroom of a retail store. So the online offer is always very big, and you can make easily your choice. You can make easy selections online. But of course, you don't have the physical experience of the merchandise. You actually want to touch some products before you buy them. So a physical store needs to offer this touch, this sensual element. And what you see now is that increasingly online brands, like this eyewear brand from the United States, Warby Parker, they started as online only, is now creating more and more physical stores. This one is the one in New York, as a physical representation of the brand, but also as a first point of connection to the merchandise. Of course, they sell here, but this kind of space also functions as some kind of showroom. It lets you touch the product, try the product, talk to sales staff, and maybe you don't buy here, but you still buy online. But the story that physical stores will disappear, I don't believe. For exactly this reason, you see more and more online stores, web stores, open physical stores, and that's not for nothing. This is also an interesting one, a sneaker shop in Melbourne. It only offers high-end sneakers, and you can, well, choose the one that you like here, but you actually cannot take it home with you. You can buy it here, but you have to buy it on those iPads. And then you will get the shoes that you want to buy sent to your home 3 days later from a central warehouse, not in Melbourne, but in Hong Kong. And the idea is that the physical footprints of the stores can be much smaller, because these stores don't have to have a stockroom. And then there's another online company like Mate in London. They make furniture, they sell furniture, and it's again started as an online company, as a web store. But also they have physical stores right now, showrooms more. And the interesting thing of their showrooms is that they not show, of course, everything, but they project some of their products on the walls to make you feel that there is more than only this product which has a physical presence in the store. It's a very clever combination of physical and digital. So in the end, you, a question. Might be a different target group, yes, but not necessarily. I think it will be a mix of both. Who of you buys clothing online? It's about 10%, it's not so much. So the rest of you prefers to go to a physical store. And of the people who buy online, the 10%, who of you also buys in physical stores? I guess you're all the same. No one only buys online. No one in the future, I think, only buys in physical stores. It will be a combination of both. I am of a little bit older generation than you. I have made a very, very few purchases online because I actually like to try something before I buy. And I don't like to go through the hassle of trying something I order online, trying it on at home, finding it's not my size, having to send it back. I hate that kind of stuff. So that's why I only buy online if I know the brand and if I know that that the shape of their clothing and the sizing of their clothing is a good match for me. But in order to find that out, I have to go to a physical store. So how do you drive traffic to physical stores? Simply by just being there, that's one reason. By letting people know online that there's also a physical store. And I think by communicating through social media also. So it's a variety of instruments that you can use to drive traffic to physical stores. But in the end, that physical store needs to talk to you, it needs to speak to you, it needs to engage you, to tell stories, and actually, that's your job. That was my second presentation. Any further questions? Nope. Then. Okay.
Do you see any trend of the business owners who are the owners of the retail going towards more centralizing the retail, more parts of the budget towards that, or going more towards communication, or they are going towards the direction of the sensations and the past? Do you have the
And well, there are two kinds of business owners, the small businesses, the personal businesses. I think they have many difficulties surviving because they don't have the budget to invest in experiential interiors, and neither do they have the budget to invest in big online stores. So the only thing they can do is getting to know their audience, their clients very well, and buy stock that they think will fit their audience very well. That's the only opportunity, I think, for small shop owners to survive. The brands, on the other hand, like Prada and, well, all of the other big brands, the big fashion brands, Nike also, they do all of that, everything you mentioned. So they invest a lot of money in experiential interiors. They invest a lot of money in web stores and having a web presence. They invest a lot of money in events. They invest a lot of money in social media presence. They invest a lot of money still in advertising. They do all of that because retail has become increasingly difficult over the last 5 years, and that's especially because of the reasons I just mentioned. And now I somehow have lost my presentation. This should be on the screen, yeah. Thank you. One of the questions that, sorry, more questions? No. One of the questions of Daniela was, how do you pitch a project? You will all become interior designers. You will all have clients in the end, I hope. If you want to convince a client, you have to pitch your project, your concept to the client. How do you do that? I can show you what the designers of the frame store has showed me, has showed us, to convince us of their concept. So this is their pitch of a frame store. Actually, it's not the frame stores that you have seen. This is one stage earlier. At that stage, we had ideas to erect a permanent retail store for frame, which would be called the House of Frame. And it would be a really big location. It never happened, and I'm very happy about that. Yes. So, the presentation of these designers revolved, existed only of these renderings, high quality renderings. So this is the presentation of the entrance. This is what they had in mind as some kind of corridor or hallway leading to, at the end, the restaurant. And in fact, it's only images like these with a story, of course, that they would tell alongside the images that they showed us to convince us of their project. And I'm really happy we didn't do this because we would have gone bankrupt, I'm really sure of that. But this is their presentation. It's only high-res renderings. I can tell one thing about these renderings. We also have this kind of rendering in this quality of both frame stores, so the ones that got actually built. And the reality, so the actual store, looked exactly the same as the rendering. It was amazing. So this is a very convincing way and a very realistic way, as it turned out, to present project. I don't know the program, the software program they used to create this though. And of course then you have to have an idea of the spatial layout. So this is the floor plan. And some words about to explain their concept. So this, sorry? Of course, yes, yes, yes. We briefed them.
Yeah, you briefed them, but did they communicate anything to you about the project and what you saw? So you had an idea in your head or not?
Yes, we had an idea. We wanted the store, well, experiential and all of that. We told them this is our budget. This we will be selling, so this will be these will be the products for sale, and these are the events that will take place in the store. And we also wanted to have a little restaurant there. And then they came up with all this. And before that, of course, there were some questions from them, but this is what they came up with. There was no further communication in between.
And did you brief several firms, or is
no.
it just one?
No, just one, just this one.
Is it always I-29?
In this case, yes, but the show in Milan was designed by Ferruccio Laviani, so it's not always them. But one thing I learned is that they live and work in Amsterdam. They work with a local contractor, and they manage this contractor. So they can speak their own language. They know the contractor, which is which has been very beneficial, because there were no problems of communication between the designers and the contractor whatsoever. Then the same designers, I-29, worked on our project in Cologne for the Cologne Trade Fair. They were dealing with a German contractor, and the trade fair was in between us, the designer, trade fair, contractor. Lots and lots of things got lost in communication, I can tell you. The contractor couldn't manage the budget that we had, so the designers had to adjust their ideas, their drawings. And in the end, it became some kind of nightmare, and it was a very diluted version of the original idea of the designers. And this was only because they could not work directly with the contractor of their choice, and lots of communication problems occurred. So then we thought, for Milan, we had to work with a local architect, Ferruccio Laviani, and let him choose the contractor, let him own the budget, and deal with the contractor directly without us being the in-between. And again, this worked perfectly. So it is very important to have a good relationship and to be on the same page, to speak somehow the same language as the company that will actually build your project. Otherwise, lots and lots of things can go wrong and get lost into translation. That is kind of all I had in mind to tell you. I don't know if you want to discuss anything else. How to
so you already chose them, so I'm curious, why did you select them?
I-29, you mean? That is a very good question. Because they were local. So we work in Amsterdam, and they also work in Amsterdam. We knew them, so we knew that we would have a good personal relationship. We very much liked their work. We knew that many of their projects had won prizes, and we kind of felt that they would be able to manage our budget, to stay within our budget. So for all those reasons, we chose to work with them. But for me, it has been very important to have a good personal relationship with them, because it should also be some kind of fun to work on a project like this, which is very stressful if you're the client with a limited budget and high ambitions. In our case, you have to make sure that's also kind of fun to work on the project, and you don't want to take many risks. So that's how we chose them.
It has something to do with the I-29 design. But when you think about the impact that has the design industry, the editorial design in the industry, that's when you publish something, it goes viral because of social media, Instagram.
Yes. Did everyone get the question? I think so. I think the impact is very big. I think that since, let's say, 2007, when we saw the rise of all these websites publishing lots of projects, interiors, buildings, products, with millions of readers, I think that it is impossible not to be influenced looking at all those images. So I think the impact is very, very big. This has meant that the average level of design has gone up dramatically. If I look at the general level of interior design, late 90s, and compare it with the level now, the business has become so much more professional, and designers have become so much more masters of the spaces they have to design. You cannot compare that to the situation 15 or 20 years ago. So the industry has gone through not an evolution, but perhaps a revolution. Anyone in the world knows is such a job as interior designer or interior architect, whereas 15 or 20 years ago, people would go to either an architect who would create a space, or a decorator / stylist who would decorate the space. Now we know, now everyone knows, every client knows, every company, every brand knows that there are people like you, interior designers, who can deal with the architect on the one hand, with the user on the other hand, so make a space available for its users, make it work for its users, and who is in sync with the zeitgeist, with the sign of the times, with what is trendy, what is fashionable. And what is fashionable, what is trendy, what's current, you pick up from the websites and from media. Of course, it's very important, I think, to still develop your own language and your own vision, your own signature, and not to become a copycat. We have seen many interiors passing by through emails or, otherwise, of projects that we could exactly pinpoint to its origins. So we could see at some point projects dealing with, I don't know, with lots of black and white and a special shape, and we could say, hey, this is very reminiscent of that project. This is probably the original source of inspiration for that project, and we would not publish it because it was not original enough. And I think it is a challenge these days to be, on the one hand, updated and to know what's going on, and on the other hand, have a strong voice of yourself, and therefore you can only do one thing, and that is shutting off and going inside, looking inside, and find your own strength and your own vision, your own signature. To deal with those two aspects is very challenging. I can totally understand that. It also affects me, because I look at many other magazines, I look at many websites, yet we want to make a magazine and we want to create a website and we want to create events which are different than all the rest. But I cannot help to be influenced by all the rest. And it's also good to be influenced in some way, if only so that you know what you don't have to do, because it already has been done. I don't know if that's an answer.
Design. So for example, a site data, I don't really be looking at the design.
You would like to know who are the trend-setting retail designers? So the designers. I think Nendo is a very good one. They put out a lot of projects, not only spaces but also products. They are originally from Japan, but you probably know them. I think they always mention to reinvent themselves and to come up with a really strong concept that somehow works. I like the work of March Studio. They have done quite some ASAP projects and some restaurants. I think their work is very architectural, but is also speaking to the senses. It's very experiential. They know how to create an engaging interior. Universal Studio, which is the studio of Baba Osgabi in London. I think they are very trendy. They make very trendy work with all the right colors and all the right materials. OMA, one of the very few architects' office, I think they make really good and strong retail projects. Also Snøhetta from Norway originally. I showed you two of their retail stores. Not many architects master the design of an interior. Only a few do, in my opinion. Well, and OMA and Snøhetta are among those. To continue the list, which ones? I like the work of quite a young French studio called Cigu. C-I-G-U-E. They start to come up, and they make work that is rather rough. The Julien David store in Tokyo, that is created by Cigu. And then I think we will see a lot more from Snarkitecture from New York. It's a very small office still, but highly original work. Snarkitecture. Schemata from Japan. That's the company of Joe Nagasaka. He is a very silent designer. He doesn't speak with a loud voice. I mean, he literally doesn't, but also his projects, they are quite toned down. But still, there's always something surprising. Well, that's more or less it. Goodbye. Else? Pick my brain? Yes.
What do you think of the future of papers, magazines, sort of, in comparison to the rise of digital media? Is it, do you think we're going to gradually buy less?
Doesn't work anyway, the mic. Go ahead.
So how do you think it's going to go?
No, it's a very big question, and you effectively asked me to look into the future. Well, I don't have my crystal ball with me. It was too heavy to take with me to Barcelona. But if I would gaze in it in Amsterdam, I think, I think there will always be a future for magazines. But magazines will become smaller, I think, and there will be even more magazines. What we have seen in our field, and it's not only in design and and architecture, but also in fashion and in any other discipline, food also, is the rise of niche publications. Very small publications catering to a very specific audience or even dealing with a very specific trend, like Kinfolk magazine. They are right on trend, and this kind of magazine couldn't even exist 10 or 15 years ago because the trend didn't exist and the audience didn't exist. There were no hipsters 20 years ago. So Kinfolk would be without any chance if it would have been published by then. So we will always see the birth of new magazines dealing with new phenomena, with new trends. And I think the really big magazines, the Elle's, the Vogue's, the newspapers, they will simply become smaller. And they will lose ground to niche publications on one hand and to the digital world and experiences on the other hand. But I want to believe that there will always be space for magazines. Because as I told you, we have done many reader surveys and we also have a digital version of the magazine that we make, Frame magazine, and not many people are buying it. They still prefer paper. I strongly believe that websites are there to spread the news and to make connections, give a certain experience. And this is what magazines can do.
For me, there's a big difference. And by magazine, I can really share that magazine as encyclopedia for something that I really want to memorize. And on the internet, it's always like, okay, I got the information and I store it somewhere, but it doesn't
stick.
And I don't know.
Do you have the same experience? So if you go to a website and you look at the images, they don't linger in your mind as much as you do, as they do when you would see the same images in the magazine. Yes, it's a very fast medium, websites. You are on one website on one moment, and the next moment you're on another website, and then another website, etc., etc.
So you put it in there and you go on and on and on. It doesn't stay with you because you didn't.
course, every magazine, bless you, every magazine has its own way of selecting content. We choose according to the following principles. It should be new, or at least we should think it is new, because we don't know everything, we haven't seen everything, but we should have the feeling that something is new, so its appearance should be new. It should have high quality, so the execution should have high quality. It should be, we like expressive interiors. Not every interior is expressive, especially this room is not very expressive. I can imagine that you fall asleep after a long day or a long week. And we also like projects with a new concept. So a kids store that looks completely different and it works completely different than other kids stores. Or the sneaker store that I showed you, which is a combination of going to a website and being in a physical store. So you order on the iPad. This kind of concept we are also looking for. So something new, something good, something expressive, and something with a strong concept. That is effectively what we are looking for. Many people and many designers, brands, they approach us. And not only us, they approach everyone. And of course, we also scout ourselves. So we look on all kinds of blogs, all kinds of websites. We go to design festivals, design weeks. We even go to graduation shows at schools to scout, to look what's happening there. And this is the way we gather content. But I think in many cases, there is simply a designer, a PR office, or the marketing department of a brand that is sending a project to us and to many other publications. I'm sorry? If you, of course, if you have a graduation show and you show your work, I'm happy to come. Yes. Actually, earlier this week I went to Oslo to witness the graduation of interior design students there, and I actually had to give them marks. So I had to read through their thesis at home and look at their portfolio of their graduation project, and then give them a mark, so I could be the judge of their work and say, you failed, or you can go, they all succeeded. But that was a very nice thing to do. It took a lot of time to read through all the theses and to look through all the portfolios, but for me, it's a way to know what's going on at, at young people like you. What are you thinking about? How are you, which aesthetics do you have? What kind of concepts do you think are interesting? It's very good for me to know.
About the sneakers program.
Yes.
Okay, so in 3 days you will have the sneakers, and for 10 minutes that all of them
Would you like to wait for 3 days?
No.
No. Me neither. So this concept is very beneficial for the retailer, for the store. It is not beneficial for the client. Times they change, yes. Yeah, now you have in the fashion world the see now, buy now principle, which is going to happen soon. So at the moment a fashion collection is launched, you can already buy it in stores, in selected stores. We'll see what that means. Lots of new concepts in the retail world, always. So the question was, how does frame work with how many people do we work? Well, we are a publishing company by now, so we not only make frame, but also Mark magazine about architecture. We used to publish Elephant magazine about art, but we have sold that recently. We now publish Foam magazine about photography, and we are working on the launch of a fashion magazine called Toile. And that will be launched in September this year. We also make books. Together we are 25. We are three editors working on frame and three graphic designers working on frame. And they also work on books and on Mark magazine. The editorial team of Mark magazine, two editors, but they all work with a network of freelancers, writers from Tokyo to New York to Barcelona. At the moment, no one in Barcelona, who write about local projects and interview local people, and who also give us advice what to write about. So in a way, it's a very small operation in Amsterdam with a very big network. And we actually do go ourselves to many events, festivals, fairs, whatsoever, but we also send freelance writers to those events, so it's a mix. If you compare Frame magazine to a magazine like Wallpaper, Wallpaper is much and much bigger. They have many more editors, and it's a far bigger publication and bigger magazine. And then of course you have even smaller magazines than Frame, made by two or three people. That was how we worked too, almost 20 years ago, and we are now 25. Okay.